at University of Michigan as a fellow, and then faculty, and now currently chief at University of Michigan. And Bill's been really a champion for a lot of things that were probably, when he started, weren't kind of at the top of everyone's list. But he's done. He's brought science to a lot of these areas. I'm remembering, you know, your early stuff on the FODMAP diet, you know, funded and investigated and really kind of proved it for what the value that it has. And what I've also noticed in recent years is using social media, using IT, using apps to help with things like hypnosis and meditation, and that's just perfect for the generation that we're dealing with now. Let me just. So what's fun is that we get to hear not only what the current strategy is, but really maybe a little glimpse of what's coming as well. Not only the drugs that are available, but how to use them. And this is how you do it. You know, you get somebody who's been with it. I'm sure you've probably seen all these drugs as they've come through development, and you know their good sides and some of their dark sides too, probably. So we're going to have it. And if people pop in with a burning question during, just go ahead and raise your hand. Otherwise, we'll just do it all at the end. And I want to be able to grab, we're recording it, so I want to be able to grab questions. So if your question, raise your hand. Don't just yell it out. Let me run over with the microphone so at least we get that on the recording then, okay? Because then we know what he's responding to when he gives his answer. And Bill, I really greatly appreciate it. And thank you again for coming down.
Well, thanks, Terry. Thanks, everybody, for coming this evening. And thank you. And it's great to be here again. Terry invited me graciously in the past, and it's always a fun thing to come down to Lexington. And I'm helping to co-mentor his daughter, Megan, who actually is taking a job back in Chicago. We're really sad because we were very much hoping that we could retain her at Michigan, but she's born and bred, and really her heart's in Chicago. So we're going to talk about constipation tonight, and we were just talking about a few moments ago about the fact that somebody was riding up on the elevator and was asked about what was going on the second floor, and they said constipation, and they immediately sort of turned and went the other way. But I'll tell you, here's the thing, is this is an incredibly exciting time right now for constipation. You're going to see, I'm certainly going to talk about the drugs like Terry talked about. And I'm also going to give you the top line from the first joint AGA-ACG clinical practice guideline, which it happens to be on constipation, coming out in June. So that is the first time that the organizations, Lin Cheng and I, got the organizations to both agree to collaborate, and there was going to be a joint guideline, one guideline from both societies. But at the end, what's really cool is you're going to see how technology is really starting to permeate gastroenterology, including DGBI, disorders of gut-brain interaction, which has not really been thought of as a technological area. But what I'll show you at the end is that there's a lot of technology that's starting to be infused and some really exciting things that are happening that are going to change the way that all of you think about how you treat patients with constipation. All right, so these are my disclosures. And then an introductory slide. Just realize this is an incredibly common problem. So upwards of 10% of the U.S. population experiences constipation. So this is an incredibly common problem, 35 million people or thereabouts. 60% estimated it interfered with their activities at least 4 days per month. Okay, so, and it's the fourth most common GI symptom, leading to over 3 million outpatient visits in the U.S. per year. So this is a big deal. I mean, it may seem like kind of a trivial thing. Actually, to gastroenterologists, I think, really do have an appreciation for how much these patients suffer. I always find it interesting that if you ask most people and even most doctors, what's more bothersome, diarrhea or constipation? They'll always say diarrhea. But what's interesting is if you actually look at the decrement on quality of life and the impact in terms of the number of days affected, it's much higher for constipation than it is for diarrhea. Why? Because Diarrhea is an intermittent problem. Constipation is an everyday of your life problem. And people that are really severely constipated feel miserable all the time. These are the Rome 4 criteria. Right now, by the way, we're in the process of starting Rome 5, but the Rome 4 criteria are up on the slide. It is not important to understand the details of Rome 4, but what is important, and what I think is important about this slide, is it highlights this very important truth. Constipation to patients is about much more than just not moving their bowels frequently enough. Stool frequency is an important part of the criteria. It's an important part of the patient's experience that are individuals who are constipated. But other things, hard or lumpy stools, a sensation of incomplete evacuation, the need for manual maneuvers, a sense of anorectal blockage, are as commonly reported and at least as or more bothersome to the patient than not going to the bathroom often enough. The other thing is just remember that there are a lot of patients that say they feel constipated that move their bowels every day, right? Especially patients with pelvic floor dysfunction, by the way, who oftentimes move their bowels multiple times per day, but they never feel completely evacuated. They have to use digital maneuvers. They feel this constant sense of incomplete evacuation that's incredibly bothersome to them. Stool consistency, which is an important surrogate for constipation, can be assessed using the Bristol Stool Form Scale. And you've probably all seen pictures of this by now. This has been bouncing around out there for a long, long time. The other thing just to know about the Bristol Stool Form Scale, though, is it not only correlates better with patient complaints of constipation than stool frequency, so it's actually a better surrogate for constipation than stool frequency, but as importantly, it's a poor person's way of assessing colon transit. So Bristol Stool Form type 1 and 2 are correlate pretty well, reasonably well, with delayed colon transit. Now, I say reasonably well because the R value is about 0.4 to 0.5, so it's statistically significant, but it's not a great correlation, okay? But there is a correlation between colon transit and the Bristol Stool Form Scale. By the way, type 6 and 7 are correlated with rapid transit. So what are the causes for chronic constipation? Well, there are a whole variety of things that can lead to constipation that are certainly worth knowing about, things from the mechanical obstruction, like a malignancy, which is what patients worry about the most, to things like drugs or medications, supplements. Supplements are really important to think about. Make sure you always ask what patients are taking, not only their prescription medications, but all the other stuff they're taking. Remember that a lot of people are taking calcium, a lot of people are taking iron, a lot of people are taking a whole variety of different substances that can predispose to the development of constipation. Also, diseases of the central nervous system and autonomic nervous system, neurological disorders in general are oftentimes associated with chronic constipation. Remember, spinal cord injury patients, 100% constipated. Every spinal cord injury patient, virtually, has some degree of constipation. Parkinson's disease, a lot of people talk about constipation as being one of the predisposing symptoms to the development of Parkinson's disease. For those individuals who do not have a readily identifiable cause for their constipation, i.e. secondary constipation, for individuals that have so-called primary constipation, the two main mechanisms which have been implicated include slow or delayed colon transit and an evacuation disorder. Now, here's the interesting thing to know about that. You see this Venn diagram, and you notice the biggest circle on the Venn diagram is normal. And that's because in studies that have been done where people have been carefully interrogated with a colon transit study, anorectal manometry, balloon expulsion test, It turns out that at least 30 to 40% of constipated patients, patients that say that they feel constipated, have totally normal studies, okay, which tells us that our studies are either not as sensitive as we'd love to believe, or there are other mechanisms outside of transit and evacuation disorders that lead to constipation that we don't fully understand yet. Okay, so, and I think that's entirely possible, by the way. Now, evacuation disorders, you'll notice I didn't say dyssynergic defecation, because dyssynergic defecation is only one type of evacuation disorder. Evacuation disorders can be split into those that are functional, i.e. dyssynergia, and we'll talk about that more in a moment, or they can be structural. So things like enteroceles and a susception, rectoceles, rectal prolapse, or an anal stricture, or a distal colonic stricture. All of those things can lead to an evacuation disorder. And it's important to remember that as gastroenterologists, we tend to focus on dyssynergia. But one of the reasons why a digital rectal examination is so important in a constipated patient is just to make sure there's not any evidence of distal mechanical obstruction. So the clinical approach to chronic constipation. So this is an algorithm that was created by the Rome Foundation a number of years ago, and we're going to walk through this. It's actually very simple. So if a patient has typical constipation-related symptoms, and remember that a holistic view would say hard or lumpy stools, a sensation of incomplete evacuation, reduced stool frequency, the need for digital maneuvers, or a sense of anorectal blockage, any of those symptoms, you're going to do a careful history and physical examination, as we just talked about. And you're going to exclude alarm features, which we'll touch on more in just a moment. If there are alarm features present, you're going to do a more detailed evaluation to address those alarm features before moving on to empiric therapy. Here are those alarm features, which you're all very familiar with. I don't think we need to review these. But for those individuals that don't have alarm features, going on to empiric therapy is entirely reasonable. But here's the thing, especially for us as gastroenterologists, each of you are going to have to decide at what point you're going to think about physiologic testing to better understand the underlying cause for a patient's constipation. In general, almost universally, every guideline says that you should treat empirically first and reserve testing for individuals who don't respond to empiric therapy. But none of the guidelines specify whether that's after OTC therapy or whether that's after prescription therapy. That's up to you. The most important thing is not necessarily when you do it. It's the most important thing is that you think about doing it and do it in patients who have not responded to therapy, however you define that. The other thing to remember is that when you do physiologic testing, you're always going to start with the pelvic floor first. You're always going to start with excluding an evacuation disorder before you do colon transit testing. Why? Because remember that a colon transit test will be abnormal in many individuals that have an evacuation disorder, not because they have delayed colon transit, but because they have an evacuation disorder. So you need to address the pelvic floor and an evacuation disorder first, and only then move on to colon transit studies. In general, too, colon transit studies don't change management very often, if you think about it. The one time when a colon transit study is really important is in the circumstance where you're even considering the possibility of doing a colectomy. If you're doing a colectomy, you must do an evaluation for an evacuation disorder, and you must do a colon transit study. Medical legally, for no other reason. Moving back to dyssynergia, remember that one of the most accessible means by which to do a preliminary evaluation for dyssynergia is with a digital rectal examination, okay? And the digital rectal examination, if you think about it, if you do a detailed digital rectal examination, you can identify all of the key elements that define the presence of dyssynergic defecation. So going through those things one by one. First thing is the inability to adequately contract your abdominal wall musculature, which increases intrarectal pressure. So it creates that propulsive force to push stool out of the rectum. Next, relaxation of the puborectalis, which allows straightening of the anorectal angle, which facilitates passage of stool into the distal rectum. And then finally, with simulated defecation, relaxation of the anal sphincter, which allows stool to be evacuated from the rectum. So you need the propulsive force by contracting your abdominal wall musculature, straightening of the anorectal angle through relaxation of the puborectalis, and relaxation of the anal sphincter. And you can do that all with your index finger during a digital rectal examination. So it turns out it's actually a reasonably sensitive and specific test to screen for dyssynergia. It's not perfect by any means, but it's a pretty good test. And certainly if you're in a situation where you don't have access to anorectal manometry, balloon expulsion testing, or imaging like defecography or defecating MRI, digital rectal examination is a really important tool to make sure that you understand how to use. So in regards to these other tests, I've already stole my own thunder and emphasized that you want to do testing for an evacuation disorder first, and only in the circumstance where you're thinking about surgery, probably think about doing a colon transit study. There's a table, and these will be on the slides. Will these be available for everybody?
Yeah.
Terry? So you might want to take a look at this, but this is sort of my two-by-two table thinking in terms of how to interpret ARM and balloon expulsion testing, because usually almost every lab that does one does both these together, an anorectal manometry and a balloon expulsion test. Bottom line is that the ANMS, American Neurogastroenterology and Motility Society, the AGA, as well as the Rome Foundation, all say that you need two tests positive to define the presence of dyssynergic defecation. So you must have at least two of anorectal manometry, balloon expulsion testing, or defecography. And for ARM and BET, if you have both tests normal, so you can relax the anal sphincter during simulated defecation and you pass a balloon within 60 seconds, you do not have an evacuation disorder, and you can move on. You can just treat as constipation. On the other hand, if you have an abnormal balloon expulsion test, so the inability to pass a balloon, and a paradoxical contraction of the anal sphincter during attempted defecation, by definition, you have dyssynergic defecation. You go directly to physical therapy and biofeedback training. For the ones that are in between, I would actually think about imaging. I would think about getting defecography or a defecating MRI as a tiebreaker to determine whether somebody has a true evacuation disorder or just, for example, a false positive result on anorectal manometry. And we can talk about this more at the end. I know that's a lot to go through, but literally that's what I teach our fellows every year. All right, treatment options. This is where we're going to spend the bulk of our time. And if you think about it, the treatment approach to patients with chronic constipation is a graded approach. You're always going to start at the bottom with a discussion of diet, behavioral advice, including toileting advice, making a positive diagnosis and explaining what that means to the patient, reassuring them that it doesn't mean they're going to get cancer or inflammatory bowel disease, for example, which is what most patients are worried about. As you move up the pyramid, you're, of course, going to start to think about pharmacotherapy. And certainly, if you're at the top of the pyramid, you're almost always going to need a multidisciplinary approach. Okay, so medications alone are not going to cut it for most patients with really severe constipation. You're going to have to think about the combination of things like diet, behavior, medications, as well as potentially physical therapy for patients with an evacuation disorder. All right, so what is this picture of? Do you guys recognize this picture? It's the thinker, right, that's right, by Rodin. But what people don't realize is that the thinker is the perfect depiction of the position you should be in when you're defecating. So some toileting tips, and this is actually available through the ACG. So sitting on the toilet in the recommended position is really important. And the recommended position is leaning slightly forward with your elbows on your thighs or close to your knees, having your knees higher than your hips. Okay, and that's, by the way, the whole point of squatty potty. Breathing is also really important. And part of breathing is belly breathing when you're trying to defecate. So when you inhale, trying to expand your abdomen, sort of thinking about towards your belly button and directing that the pressure in your belly towards your rectum. And it's amazing. Nobody, including me, actually, until I sort of looked through the literature and tried to understand all this in terms of the physiology of all this. My suspicion is nobody ever has talked to you about how you should be talking to your patients about toileting, but a lot of times, well, put it this way, this is an important part of physical therapy and biofeedback training. It's just this, by the way. So this leads into a discussion of that joint guideline that I mentioned to you a moment ago. And the joint guideline uses grade methodology. So the development of PICO questions, which are focused clinical questions that the literature is hopefully utilized to answer. We developed several pre-specified teams of experts that addressed different laxative therapies for patients with chronic idiopathic constipation. We confined our discussion to really just medical therapies for chronic idiopathic constipation. So this guideline will be on only medical therapies. These documents will be published jointly by Gastroenterology and the American Journal in June. And they should be available any day, actually, online. We just reviewed the final page proofs just recently. So we'll start. This first slide is not in the guideline, but it's an important thing for us to talk through, and that is diet and lifestyle approaches for chronic constipation. So I think you're all very familiar with the recommendation for the use of fiber in patients with chronic constipation. Probably the best evidence right now is for soluble fiber, but there's also data to suggest that some forms of insoluble fiber can also be helpful. It's really important to understand, though, that all fiber is not created equally. Okay, so let me just give you an example. So coarse bran can lead to benefits in constipation. Finely ground bran actually can worsen constipation. Okay, so the particle size appears to make a difference. The solubility and fermentability also appears to make a difference. Let me give you another example. You're all familiar with psyllium, so I'm not going to talk about that. But inulin, are you guys familiar with inulin? So inulin is, of course, a FODMAP, but it's a soluble fiber. Okay, so inulin is actually used as an aid for patients with constipation. Why? Because it's 100% non-digestible by the human small intestine. It gets to the colon where it's metabolized or fermented by the colon bacteria to produce short-chain fatty acids, which create an osmotic effect and exert a laxative effect. The other thing about inulin is that it's a prebiotic laxative fiber. Okay, so it actually promotes the growth of bacteria that are felt to be potentially beneficial. So it's a prebiotic soluble, fully fermentable fiber. And that's really different than psyllium, and that's really different than bran. So just understand, when you're making these recommendations, it's really important to understand these differences between the different types of fiber. Yes?
So I usually use Fiber Choice as my inulin supplement.
Yeah. I think Fiber Choice is a perfectly fine one, and there's actually a growing number of prebiotic fiber supplements that are becoming available, a lot of them by these various supplement companies. But Fiber Choice is the one that I use as well for inulin. I don't know. I was going to say usually 2 to 4, somewhere in that neighborhood. I usually start low, like you do as well. You know, when Fiber Choice first came out, I was actually very concerned, because it is a FODMAP, that it would actually worsen patients' IBS symptoms. But interestingly, the company, at my advice, actually collected a whole bunch of post-marketing surveillance data on people starting Fiber Choice. And while some of them got a little blip when they first started, what appears to happen is the microbiome must adapt very quickly, because within a very short period of time, they go back to just baseline symptoms. So there's a benefit for the constipation, but it doesn't worsen their bloating and abdominal pain, for example. Also, you guys should know about natural laxatives. So you may have seen our work on kiwi fruit. Are you guys utilizing kiwi fruit? So that paper has kind of taken on a life of its own, and it's amazing how kiwi has really become part of the constipation lexicon now in the United States. But realize there are numerous other natural laxatives to know about. So, for example, aloe juice has stimulant laxative properties. You probably know that, but did you know rhubarb also has stimulant laxative properties? Rhubarb actually contains anthraquinones and can cause melanosis. As well, there are a variety of other fruits that contain sugars that in some people can exert laxative properties, like bananas contain a lot of fructose, for example. And mangoes, papayas, watermelon, all again related to the types of sugars they contain, for some people can exert laxative properties. They can also exacerbate bloating and gas as well. One last thing just to say about FODMAP restriction. We just presented data at the ACG meeting this past year showing that the low FODMAP diet not only improves pain and bloating in IBS-D patients, but also IBS-C and IBS-M. That we have a manuscript that's under review right now, so you can look out for that. But there may very well be a logical reason for patients that are complaining a lot of pain and bloating with IBS-C to still think about low FODMAP. All right, so here are the different drug choices that you have, OTC and prescription. And we'll go through these. These are recommendations that come right out of that joint guideline. So recommendation 1, in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation, the panel suggests the use of fiber supplementation over management without fiber supplements. This was a conditional recommendation based on low certainty of evidence. And the in this guideline, we also list, in addition to the bolded statement, a number of implementation considerations, which are sort of practical advice for clinicians utilizing these different agents in their practice. So dietary assessment is important to determine total fiber intake from diet and supplements. Here's the point. The point is that when we talk about the ideal amount of fiber being consumed per day of 20 to 30 grams, that's total fiber, including dietary fiber and supplements, not just the supplement. Please don't put patients on 20 to 30 grams of supplemental fiber. That's really cruel and unusual punishment. Fiber supplements can be used as first line for CIC, particularly in individuals with a low fiber diet. So this is the point of that statement. It's very interesting that if you look at the NHANES database in regards to the relationship between dietary fiber intake and constipation symptoms, that for individuals that are taking normal amounts of dietary fiber, there is no increase in the likelihood of constipation. Where you see constipation more likely is in individuals that are in the lowest quartile of fiber intake. So if an individual is already taking a bunch of fiber in the diet, there's no point in putting them on more fiber, okay? But on the other hand, if their diet includes a very small amount of fiber, there's a person that might really benefit from fiber supplementation. These things seem really obvious when I say them, but I'm constantly amazed at how it's a knee-jerk thing for people to just start every single person on fiber, and it's unnecessary in many people. All right, recommendation two. In patients with chronic idiopathic constipation, the panel recommends the use of PEG, polyethylene glycol, compared to management without PEG. Strong recommendation based on moderate certainty of evidence. The implementation considerations, a trial of fiber supplement can be considered for mild constipation before PEG use or in combination with PEG. I actually disagreed with this. I felt like we should say that PEG or fiber could be used as first-line therapy for constipation. I got voted down, though. The rest of the committee felt like you should try fiber first and then think about PEG. I'm going on record with you guys to say I don't agree with that. Response to PEG has been shown to be durable for 6 months, actually six-month RCTs. I'll show you one in a second. And then side effects include abdominal distension, loose stool, flatulence, and nausea. And so PEG is one of the few drugs that we have for which we actually have six-month randomized control trial data. It's both safety and efficacy data. So this really is a highly evidence-based treatment for patients with chronic idiopathic constipation. And in general, at usual doses, it's very well tolerated. Where you start getting into problems is when you're pushing the dose up two, three times, four times a day, then you start getting more problems with abdominal cramping, bloating, et cetera. The other thing is there's this other very sort of controversial tidbit out there. Did you guys see that large epidemiological study linking osmotic laxatives, specifically PEG, and a higher risk of dementia? Yeah, and it's another one of these association studies, like we've seen quite a few with PPIs, for example. So I think it's not anything to hang your hat on or get too concerned about yet, but it definitely needs some follow-up. We definitely need some follow-up information on that. All right, recommendation three is a new recommendation. How many folks recommend magnesium for their patients with constipation? So not very many, only a couple of you guys. So here's the thing. Magnesium is one of the best and mildest laxative therapies out there. Actually, for me, magnesium is absolutely one of my first-line go-to laxative therapies. And everybody coming out of Michigan sort of does this because this is sort of this. I feel very strongly about this, but I pushed for magnesium to be included in this one first, do an evidence review, and we did. And I'm glad to say that the evidence review comes out on the side of making a recommendation. Now, admittedly, it's a conditional recommendation based on very low certainty of evidence, but this is another thing to add to your tool chest. So the implementation considerations, the trials, and there are two randomized control trials, are both short-term trials, 4 weeks, which is usually what laxative trials are. The trials included magnesium oxide. Okay, now there are many, many different types of magnesium supplements on the market. The two RCTs that have been done, both in Japan, are with magnesium oxide. Okay, so that's the one, that's the evidence-based one to use. Usually, or in the two RCTs, they utilize a dosage of 1,500 milligrams of magnesium per day. That's a lot. That's a very high dose. By the way, very well tolerated, no safety issues in those Japanese RCTs. But my recommendation for you, if you're going to use magnesium oxide, 400 or 500 milligrams once per day, and you can titrate up to 1,500 milligrams if you need to. Obviously, you don't want to use magnesium supplements in individuals with significant renal insufficiency. And here's data from one of the two RCTs I told you about. 90 patients from Japan who are randomized to either placebo, and this is the data for Senna as well, placebo, Senna, or magnesium oxide. The primary outcome was overall symptom improvement. And you can see a dramatic increase in the likelihood of overall improvement of constipation symptoms with either Senna or magnesium oxide compared to placebo in this trial. Overall, both these therapies were reasonably well tolerated. In fact, I was really surprised that there wasn't more diarrhea or abdominal cramping in the magnesium or Senna groups at these doses, because these are actually, for both Senna and magnesium oxide, reasonably high doses. Recommendation 5, in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation, the panel recommends the use of bisacodyl or sodium picosulfate short-term or as rescue therapy over management without bisacodyl or SPS. So implementation considerations here, short-term use is defined as daily use for 4 weeks or less. Remember I said a moment ago that most of these constipation treatment trials are 4 weeks. This is no exception. There's one trial with bisacodyl, one trial with sodium picosulfate, both showing significant benefits. I'll show you the data in a second. But pointing out in these studies that a significant proportion of individuals will report some degree of abdominal cramping or pain. Okay, remember, it is a stimulant laxative. This is a good option for occasional use or rescue therapy in combination with other pharmacological agents for CIC. That's what the guideline says. That's how I use this in my real-world clinical practice, is that I usually try to avoid having patients take bisacodyl or sodium picosulfate, which we don't have for daily use in the United States anyway. But bisacodyl, I try to avoid having patients take that every day. I do have some patients on it every day because they're so severely constipated. But in general, I try not to do that. Why? Because we have no long-term data, and there's still that hangover effect for people concerned about the development of cathartic colon with long-term use of bisacodyl. There's no evidence of that, by the way. But nonetheless, you can imagine that the lack of evidence doesn't mean that it does or doesn't happen, and that concern still is out there. Here's data from the bisacodyl trial, which was conducted in the United Kingdom, a large registration trial, reasonably large, 368 patients with chronic constipation, 75% were female. They used bisacodyl 10 milligrams per day for 4 weeks, and they showed clear benefits for stool frequency and global assessment. They did, however, report 72% of individuals in the bisacodyl group reported at least one adverse event. So, and the vast majority of those AEs were abdominal pain or cramping. So it definitely can cause some pain and cramping, just to be aware of. And again, another reason to probably reserve it for PRN use, adjunctive therapy use, but not necessarily everyday use. Recommendation 6, in patients with CIC, the panel suggests the use of Senna over management without Senna, and that's really based on that one RCT that I showed you a few moments ago. And while the trial was conducted for 4 weeks, longer-term use is probably okay. I mean, we make that statement because Senna's been around forever. I mean, this is not like a new therapy for constipation. Remember that in ancient times, like the Egyptians, the Chinese were all using Senna as a natural treatment for constipation. The dose in that one study I showed you is a bit higher than the usual dose for Senna. And the panel suggests starting at a lower dose and increasing as tolerated. Abdominal pain and cramping may occur in higher doses, but interestingly, were not reported even at the doses in that randomized controlled trial. So moving on to the FDA-approved prescription options, which are also included in the guideline, these would include the prosecretory agents, so lubiprostone, linaclotide, and placanotide, which are all FDA-approved for chronic idiopathic constipation. It turns out that all three are also approved for IBS with constipation. Now, there is another drug that's not on this slide, and that's tenapanor, which you probably heard about. It's a new drug that's FDA approved for IBS with constipation, but it's not FDA approved for chronic idiopathic constipation. In the prokinetic category, tegaserod is no longer available in the United States. The only 5-HT4 agonist or prokinetic for chronic idiopathic constipation that's available in the United States is prucalopride. Okay, it's prucalopride. Is a fairly specific 5-HT4 agonist. So recommendation 7 starts to build on these different prescription drugs. First one is on lubiprostone, which is recommended over management without lubiprostone, a conditional recommendation based on low certainty of evidence. These are, again, 4-week treatment trials. The main side effect associated with the use of lubiprostone is nausea. Okay, remember that nausea is very closely linked to dose. The FDA-approved dosage for lubiprostone is 24 micrograms twice daily with food. With that dose, around 28 to 30% of patients on lubiprostone will get some degree of nausea. Okay, and that's with food, by the way. That's nausea rate is with food. The good news is the vast majority of the time it's very mild and it goes away on its own. So it's usually not a deal breaker, but it is something to know about. The other dose that's available in the United States is 8 micrograms twice a day, and that's for IBS-C. There's very little nausea actually associated with that dose. So it's dose-dependent nausea. Dose it with food. This is some of the phase 3 data for lubiprostone and chronic idiopathic constipation. And, bottom line here is that symptom improvement occurred to a greater degree with lubiprostone for stool frequency straining and constipation severity in this randomized controlled trial. Recommendation 8, in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation who have not responded to over-the-counter agents, the panel recommends the use of linaclotide over management without linaclotide. And so remember that linaclotide is a guanylate cyclase C agonist, so it binds the GCC receptor, and that leads to the production of intracellular cyclic GMP. That cyclic GMP actually opens CFTR, the cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator, which is arguably the most important chloride channel on the apical surface of the enterocyte. Another interesting feature of linaclotide is that that cyclic GMP that's produced inside the cell, some of it passively and actively migrates through the basolateral surface of the enterocyte and actually has an inhibitory effect on visceral afferent neurons, which are responsible for the sensation of pain and bloating. And it's been argued that is one of the mechanisms that underlies the benefits of pain and bloating of linaclotide and placanotide, by the way, too. Both of them work as agonists of the GCC receptor. So this drug actually has RCT data in IBS-C up to 6 months. In chronic constipation, there are 4-week trials again, but for IBS-C, actually up to 6 months, so more robust data. It may be associated with side effects of diarrhea. Remember that particularly the higher doses of linaclotide are associated with a diarrhea rate that's in the range of 18 to 20%. So somewhere between 1 in 5 or so patients with linaclotide will report some degree of diarrhea. Now, it's one way to try to reduce the development of diarrhea is to have the patient take it on an empty stomach. So remember, lubiprostone, we said, with food to reduce nausea. Linaclotide on an empty stomach. Why? Because linaclotide, remember I told you, is an agonist of the GCC receptor. Well, what's the natural agonist for the GCC receptor? And that's food. Okay, so if you give linaclotide with food, you're going to really amp up the binding of the GCC receptor and really increase the likelihood of getting diarrhea. By the way, a pro tip is if you're using linaclotide and it hasn't worked, give it with food and see if it helps.
Does it help it with some of your patients with abdominal pain? I really like that.
Yeah.
Potential. Does it
yes, absolutely. And when we published the phase 3 trials in IBS-C, this is quite a few years ago. I think it was 2017 that we published those trials, maybe even 2014. One of the things that I was most impressed with in terms of the data with linaclotide was a significant reduction, 40-50% reduction in abdominal pain and bloating scores. But what's really interesting, the most interesting thing about the data is the way that for stool frequency, linaclotide leads to maximum benefit within 2 to 3 days. So within the first, second, or third dose, you're at max effect in terms of stool frequency. On the other hand, for pain and bloating, it's probably 4 to 8 weeks before you see maximum benefit. So there's often a disconnect between the temporal association between benefits for stool frequency and benefits for pain and bloating, which you could argue speaks to the possibility of a different mechanism, as I laid out. It's also possible, by the way, that it just takes a bit of time for the neurons to remodel, related to the fact that your colon's all stretched out from being, expanded over and over again by constipation, and that it just takes time for your visceral hypersensitivity to improve. And so it might also, that probably also is playing a role in addition to the mechanism that I laid out for you that's been shown in animals. Yeah. No. So the question was, is there any convincing data that linaclotide might be beneficial for gastroparesis? And the answer is no. An interesting question, though, is whether or not there's any benefit of linaclotide for functional dyspepsia. Which is more of a visceral hypersensitivity kind of disorder like IBS, and the answer is we don't know. There hasn't been the study that's been done. It's an interesting question. The obvious thing to be concerned about would be taking normal people and putting them on linaclotide, in terms of a very high rate of getting diarrhea. But it's an interesting question, and there have been some studies. We actually published a study with Ironwood utilizing different formulations of linaclotide released in different parts of the small intestine or colon and assessing the impact on pain, showing some differences in the pain effect based upon where the drug is released. So there's more work needs to be done on that is the bottom line. All right, here's the primary constipation data published by Tony Lembo in the New England Journal back in 2011. Showing clear benefits for increasing stool frequency in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation, but also on this visual right panel, improvements in bloating scores with linaclotide in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation. So recommendation 9, in patients with CIC who do not respond to over-the-counter agents, the panel recommends the use of placanotide over management of without placanotide, strong recommendation based on moderate certainty of evidence. A couple of interesting features about placanotide. First thing is it doesn't matter whether you give it with or without food. So remember I said lubiprostone with food, linaclotide without food. Placanotide doesn't matter. You can give it with or without food. The main side effect is diarrhea. There's a lot of debate about the percentage of patients that get diarrhea. I don't even want to get into that. There's also 6-month data for IBS-C with placanotide as well. Here's the chronic idiopathic constipation phase 3 data showing clear benefits on stool frequency in individuals treated with placanotide 3 milligrams once a day versus placebo. So recommendation 10, in patients with chronic idiopathic constipation who do not respond to OTC agents, the panel recommends the use of prucalopride over management without prucalopride. Strong recommendation based on moderate certainty of evidence. So the implementation considerations here, the duration of treatment in the trials was up to 6 months, but the drug label does not provide a limit for treatment use. It can be used as a replacement or an adjunct to OTC agents, as all the prescriptions of medications have said. And it possesses general prokinetic properties, which may be useful in individuals with upper GI symptoms. Okay, so to your question for gastroparesis, here there is evidence You may have seen a small trial that was published by Brian Lacey and colleagues using prucalopride in patients with gastroparesis, showing benefits both on accelerating gastric emptying and improving dyspeptic symptoms. So this is probably the preferred drug for patients with overlapping upper and lower symptoms. And this can be taken with or without food. Here's some amalgamated data for prucalopride, data from 6 randomized controlled trials, a huge data set, almost 2,500 patients included in this meta-analysis. And bottom line is for mean stool frequency of greater than 3 complete spontaneous bowel movements per week, you can see an almost 2-fold increased likelihood of response in men and women with prucalopride compared to placebo. So a very robust data set. I did throw this one slide in on tenapanor. It is not included in the guideline because remember that I said that tenapanor is FDA approved for IBS-C but not CIC. By the way, prucalopride is FDA approved for CIC but not IBS-C. Okay, and the reason why I'm mentioning all this over and over again is because it's really important to link the right diagnosis to your prescriptions when you're writing them. Otherwise, insurance will not cover it. So, like, for example, if you write prucalopride and you link it to IBS-C, it will not be covered. Similarly, if you write tenapanor and you link it to chronic idiopathic constipation, it will not be covered. So that's probably the only place where I find these distinctions useful, to be frank. I think in clinical practice, we all are very aware of the fact that there's tremendous overlap between these conditions. Patients move in and out of these categories over time. But for insurance reasons, it's very important to understand the FDA-approved indication. Bottom line here is that tenapanor not only improves stool frequency, but Terry, to the point we were talking about earlier, also abdominal pain and bloating as well again. And there does seem to be a delay again in the onset of benefit for pain and bloating compared to the benefit for stool frequency again. So, begging the question, you know, is it more related to unloading the colon, fixing their constipation, and allowing the visceral hypersensitivity to resolve on its own, or is there a separate mechanism? Here, this drug has been implicated with a CGRP-related mechanism for improvement in abdominal pain. All right, so this is the part that I think is really cool, the non-medical part. The first part, you all know, which is that when you find a patient that has dyssynergic defecation, the treatment of choice is physical therapy and biofeedback training. And you'll notice I said physical therapy and biofeedback training, okay, because biofeedback training in and of itself is efficacious, but the physical therapists are highly trained to deal with things like pelvic pain, abdominal massage, a variety of different techniques that extend well beyond just biofeedback training, which can be remarkably beneficial to your patients with constipation. So I really feel that the best person to administer the physical or the biofeedback training is a physical therapist who will do a detailed evaluation and use techniques beyond biofeedback. This is data on acupuncture, and you may or may not have seen this. The reason why I say that is may or may not have seen this is because one of the trials you'll notice was published in the Annals of Internal Medicine. And the study that was in Annals was a really well-done randomized controlled trial that included over 1,000 patients with Rome-defined functional constipation from a number of different centers in China. Who then randomized patients to electroacupuncture at ST36, which is the standard acupuncture point for chronic constipation. But this was electroacupuncture administered by an expert. And what you can see is a clear separation in the curves for stool frequency with electroacupuncture versus sham electroacupuncture. The data on your visual left is from a smaller randomized control trial, but also showing benefits for for electroacupuncture at the same point in a different randomized controlled trial. So we believe in this so much that we're actually starting to do this next month. We're actually going to be offering an acupuncture clinic as part of our integrated care program. So we have seven dietitians, three behavioral psychologists, and now one acupuncturist who will do actually two full days of acupuncture per week only for the GI service.
Is it reimbursed?
Some of it is reimbursed. Some of it, a lot of it is cash on the barrel. I can tell you that my sister is actually an acupuncturist, and she has, and they take no insurance, and they have a 6-month wait list. Yes. You have to, it can be. You have to view this as almost as if getting the acupuncture treatment is like taking a drug. You know, obviously there's more involved because you have to physically come in, but usually there's 3 to 4 treatments per week. And yes, that can absolutely be a barrier. Like, this is not going to be for everybody, but if you have a treatment refractory patient and you're out of medical options, this is a great way to go. It's a fantastic way to go. So that's one cool thing. And I'm going to show you data from this study, too. So I think most gastroenterologists believe that prucalopride is a very effective drug. Well, this is actually a comparative effectiveness trial looking at the benefits of electroacupuncture versus prucalopride in patients with severe chronic constipation, showing equivalence in terms of the proportion of patients responding and actually better tolerability of the acupuncture compared to prucalopride. So there's actually more data on acupuncture and constipation than there is for a lot of the drugs that I've just showed you that are in the guideline. And then there's this, the vibrating capsule. Have you heard about this? So this is also a really cool concept. So the idea that mechanical stimulation of the colon through a vibrating capsule can stimulate peristalsis and improve chronic constipation. This is data from a phase 3 trial that we just published. You know, a whole bunch of us collaborated on this and presented at DDW. You probably have heard that this capsule has actually been FDA approved and became available in the United States in January. We're going to be presenting some data at an upcoming meeting. I can't remember if it's DDW or if we're going to do it at ACG, but it's a very interesting study that actually, because we collected extensive diary data as part of this trial in terms of how often people went and what their Bristol stool form score was and what time they went to the bathroom. Here's the interesting thing. Normal people, when do they go to the bathroom? Yeah, when you get up in the morning, right? Almost everybody. If you look at people that say their bowel habits are normal, they almost all move their bowels in the morning. When do you think constipated patients move their bowels? Yeah, actually, it's interesting. There's a lot more, there's a much wider standard deviation, but it sort of centers in the afternoon. And so what people are starting to talk about is the fact that somehow the circadian rhythm in constipated patients seems to be out of whack. So the neurohormonal regulation of GI function and bowel movements seems to be out of whack in patients with constipation. So stay tuned. We're actually going to be starting some studies on this, but I think it's a very interesting angle. You know, maybe thinking about sleep, like we're talking about. Maybe thinking about function of the hypothalamic pituitary axis. There's a whole bunch of different things that you can think about in regards to this. But this really does represent that merger of technology and disease that I was talking about at the very beginning of the discussion. So putting this all together as we finish up, this is an algorithm that'll be in the joint guideline. And bottom line is that patients with constipation symptoms, you're going to rule out alarm features, as we talked about in that Rome algorithm. you're going to think about fiber in individuals who are not taking enough fiber. If a person's taking enough fiber, there's no reason to give them more fiber. If fiber doesn't work or a patient's on sufficient amounts of fiber, using an osmotic laxative is a very reasonable way to go. And that would include not just polyethylene glycol, but also magnesium oxide and lactulose, which is a prescription option. If there's an unsatisfactory response, it's your call as to when to start to think about physiological testing. But I personally don't do physiologic testing until a patient's failed one or more prescription medications, but that's just what I do. I think the most important thing, again, is for you to decide upon the availability of the testing, the practicality of the testing, and when you feel comfortable ordering the testing. The most important thing is just to make sure you think about it in the patients that aren't responding to your medical interventions. And then, of course, in addition to the medical interventions we reviewed, you want to just make sure you think about the possibility of pelvic floor dysfunction treated with physical therapy and biofeedback training. You can think about electroacupuncture. You can think about the vibrating capsule. All these things are options to you right now. I mean, the number of options we have available to us now compared to 20 years ago is mind-boggling. And by the way, there will be a lot more stuff coming down the pipe. New drugs, neuromodulation, I think, is a very exciting and interesting treatment option for patients with constipation. That's what, at the end of the day, that's what electroacupuncture is. It's neuromodulation. It's just a different form of neuromodulation. And again, remember that severely affected patients require a multidisciplinary approach. Diet, behavior, physical therapy, as well as CAM now, so things like acupuncture. So concluding remarks, constipation is a multi-symptom disorder. The main causes of constipation are slow colon transit and or disordered defecation, although a significant minority of patients will have normal evidence of defecation and normal transit, and they'll still say they're constipated. Diet, lifestyle modification, and OTC laxatives are primary therapy for patients with chronic idiopathic constipation. When patients fail to respond to laxatives, diagnostic testing should be considered. Prosecretory and prokinetic agents can be effective for subgroups of CIC patients. The vibrating capsule and electroacupuncture are novel evidence-based options for patients with constipation. And a collaborative integrated approach is best for severely affected patients. So with that, I'll stop and we'll open up for questions. Looks like we have a bunch already, so.
Refer pretty early to pelvic floor therapy if I get a patient who tells me that they're rocking forward to defecate or providing themselves perineal splinting or vaginal splinting to defecate. I tend to send those people pretty early in their course to pelvic floor therapy without doing additional testing. Do they need additional testing first?
Not necessarily. I think that's entirely appropriate. Years ago, there was a group in the United Kingdom led by a famous gastroenterologist named Michael Cam, who published a very nice study showing that that it made most sense to actually just send patients to empiric physical therapy and biofeedback training as opposed to doing testing beforehand.
Is that the St. Mark's group?
Yes, that's the St. Mark's group. And actually, we're presenting something at DDW this year, our group is, saying that from a cost standpoint, it may make sense to just send people to physical therapy and biofeedback training. So this is still a debatable topic. There's no question that you can highly enrich the proportion of patients responding if you do the testing beforehand. But if you don't have the testing, it's perfectly reasonable just to use your clinical judgment and send patients. The one thing I'll say about using your clinical judgment is we've done really detailed analyses from our databases, and bottom line is that there are no symptoms that reliably identify patients with an evacuation disorder. Like, the only one that sort of works okay is a sensation of incomplete evacuation, if you had Satish Rao here, he would say use of digital maneuvers. But even those, if you look at the proportion of individuals with constipation with and without an evacuation disorder that endorse those symptoms, it's a statistically significantly higher proportion, like 80% with an evacuation disorder. It's like 60% without an evacuation disorder. So statistically, highly statistically significantly different, clinically completely useless. Yes.
We were reviewing SIBO guidelines today, and there is this intestinal methanogen overgrowth that can present with constipation. At what time would you think about it and treat your patient with antibiotics?
That's a really interesting question as well. And here's the problem. We really don't have any studies to guide that answer. I'll tell you what I do. I don't do that testing up front in everybody. I'll usually start to think about that the same time I'm starting to think about some of these other things. Like I'll probably even do pelvic floor. I order very few colon transit studies, by the way. Like all my testing is usually either anorectomanometry or defecography. I probably will order that first, and then if that's negative and the patient's still constipated and not responding to medical therapy, that's when I'll think about doing a breath test to look for methanogens. And it's really more an act of desperation than it is an evidence-based pursuit, because if you look at the methanogen data right now, there's a lot of interesting data, and I think there's definitely some kernels of truth in there, but I really would like to see a randomized controlled trial. I really would like to see comparisons between different treatment regimens to treat methanogens. Right now, we're basing the recommendation on treatment of methanogens from data from one center in an observational cohort study, not a randomized controlled trial. You know, so we're really flying pretty blind right now. Yes.
OTC you mentioned about Senna. I just had a female patient a few months ago with the colonoscopy. The whole colon was dark,
yes,
and kind of melanosis coli. So we just think it was just color changes. There is no motility problem, no consequence of taking Senna for a long period of time.
Yeah. This remains a big concern. I think people are genuinely worried about this. And you know, especially when you show a patient pictures of their colon and it really is one, like that anaconda colon where it's just completely black. But really there have been no downstream consequences associated with even severe melanosis. It's largely reversible, you know, when you stop the senicide or the anthraquinone. And there's really no compelling data to draw a clear association between the use of the stimulants and the development of a true motility problem. There is indirect data to show that people on stimulants have motility problems, but what's the chicken and what's the egg? You know, so I think it's more a cosmetic, like melanosis, I really firmly believe right now, based on best evidence, is more of a cosmetic dilemma than it is an actual concern.
My question is about the narcotic-induced constipation, which has been very challenging for us.
Yeah.
You know, you use prescribing drugs, doesn't work, and medicine we have in market is not very effective most of the time. Do you use combination, like I myself sometimes combine with lactulose, which I have been very impressed with lactulose effect in this combination, but I was just wondering, what's your preference?
Yeah, I use combinations almost exclusively. I'd say probably 90% of the patients that I see, 80% of the patients I see are on some combination of things. And like I said, for the severely affected ones, it's not just medication. It's not just combinations of medications. It's like a whole hodgepodge of different interventions. You know, I think that, like, I even find that a lot of the opioid-induced constipation patients require a Pomora plus something else. You know, in fact, I'd say that there's very few patients that of mine that have OIC that are only on a Pomora. I do think they're highly effective, But combination therapy is, I think, more the rule than the exception. Yes.
Now, once patients already have dyssynergidifications, already have rectocele, something you find at a digital exam, suspect to difficulty, MRI, I mean, you set up in surgery and do biofeedback, pelvic therapy, what is your approach? I mean, it's already advanced patients.
Yeah, so first thing, there's a few things to just remember about rectoceles. Okay, so, you know, I work very closely with my Eurogyn colleagues, and one thing they really emphasized early on was that fixing a rectocele will never make people go to the bathroom more often. Okay, so in other words, if a patient's really severely constipated, again, you have to take a step back and ask the question, what's the chicken and what's the egg? You know, most rectoceles are actually the consequence of the constipation, not the cause for the constipation. Now, if a patient has, you've sort of made them better from a constipation standpoint, but they're still having a lot of problems with a sensation of incomplete evacuation, and they don't have evidence of dyssynergia, that's a patient that I would, and they have a significant rectocele, that's a patient where I would think about sending them over to urogynecology. But For the most part, I think that we worry more about rectoceles than we need to, which is a good thing, you know, in the sense that it's one less thing that I have to spend a lot of time worrying about. I think enteroceles are the same thing, is that enteroceles can be incredibly impressive and worrying to look at on defecography or defecating MRI. To see this huge wad of small intestine coming down into the pelvis is incredibly disconcerting. But and sometimes it can make a difference to fix them, for sure. I really believe that, because I've had several patients say that they got their life back after getting a really significant enterocele fixed. But what my Eurogyn colleagues tell me is that, on balance, for the vast majority of them, most of the time the patients don't get better with enterocele repairs. So we just have to be cautious about over-diagnosing enteroceles and rectoceles. And, you know, the surgeons we work with are incredibly responsible about not doing surgery when they don't think it's going to be helpful. But I would just say, remember that you are the shepherd for your patients. And, you know, when we send them for a surgical evaluation, our responsibility doesn't end with just writing the referral. So I would just say, particularly for those diagnoses, be careful, judicious, and thoughtful before you send them to a surgeon.
The same thing for Charcot rectal ulcer syndrome, rectal mucosa.
Yeah.
You see a lot of them.
Yeah.
Same thing.
SRUS, so solitary rectal ulcer syndrome, is a bit of a conundrum, you know, because almost always that's from rectal prolapse, you know, and so if you're having a patient that's bleeding significantly from solitary rectal ulcer syndrome, probably the only way that's going to get better is for them to get the rectal prolapse repaired. So that's a little bit of a different situation, in that there are very tangible consequences, you know, related to having chronic solitary rectal ulcer syndrome. But if you see SRUS, you should do a defecography or a defecating MR to get an idea about, to confirm the diagnosis of rectal prolapse and also get an idea about how severe it is. You should at least do a physical examination too, because you certainly, if a patient has severe rectal prolapse, you'll be able to figure that out just from physical examination. Yeah.
Thank you for a great talk, sir. I just wanted to get, if you have any specific tricks in managing a patient with acute constipation that's like third trimester pregnancy. I've had a few consultations on the weekend where you get called on a like 32-week pregnant female with acute constipation, and you're just like doing hit and trials. If you have any specific algorithm, you follow on those.
So the question has to actually, you had a microphone, so you all heard it. Treatment of acute constipation in pregnancy. There's only one drug that actually has RCT data in pregnancy, and that is lactulose. So an RCT done in China in pregnant women showed lactulose to be effective and entirely safe in pregnancy. So That would be my go-to first-line treatment for an acute situation in pregnancy. But the OBGYNs tell me that they have no concerns about PEG. They use PEG all the time, and so those would be the two that I would really stick to, is lactulose, RCT data, polyethylene glycol, sort of the seal of approval from our OBGYN colleagues.
I have a question. Have you ever used neostigmine or prostigmine?
Yeah, so certainly for pseudo-obstruction, and certainly so for either colonic or intestinal pseudo-obstruction, certainly have done that. I have not used them as chronic treatments for constipation, although I've thought about it numerous times. I've just never really gotten to the point where I've had to get to that point where I've thought about it. But I will say this: we use it for patients with chronic intestinal pseudo-obstruction, you know, oral mestinon, right? So, I must say that the patients that I have on mestinon for CIIP do just fine. So there's probably no reason not to do it. I just haven't had the need to do it as of yet. Are you doing it?
Yeah.
It's a very effective drug. You know, the other drug that we used to use for constipation is the drug that's in the news in a big way right now. That's mifepristone. That's right. That's misoprostol. Yeah. Misoprostol back in the 80s or back in the 90s was what we used for really severely constipated patients as a rescue agent, was misoprostol. Yeah.
You mentioned about physical tropopelvic dysfunction, but what is the role of exercise in constipation, given the fact many elderly people have problem with the muscle and abdominal muscle wall, and even that other people who have been in that situation?
Yeah, so the question is about the role of exercise for constipation, which is a really important question. It's important for two reasons. One is the obvious answer, which is that exercise can be highly beneficial. So realize that individuals who are active move their bowels more frequently on average than people that are sedentary. In addition, there are studies from Korea to show that if you vigorously exercise people, their colon transit actually speeds up. So exercise can have beneficial effects on colon function and transit. But the other thing, just to realize, again, like fiber, I'm going to make almost the exact same analogy. If a person's exercising already, don't make them exercise more. Okay. So here's the thing: is in that NIH database, in that same study that I quoted to you earlier, they looked at fiber consumption and they also looked at exercise. And what they found was that constipated people in general aren't exercising any less than non-constipated people. But if you're in the lowest quartile of exercise, you're more likely to be constipated. So exercise is a really good thing for most people. But obviously, if you're dealing with somebody that's exercising a lot on a regular schedule, exercising more is not going to help them a lot. Same could be said for water consumption. If you're in the lowest quartile for water consumption, you're more likely to be constipated. Constipated patients in general don't drink any less than non-constipated patients. So if they're not eating enough fiber, they're not exercising enough, they're not drinking enough water, by all means, that should be absolutely part of your treatment plan, but it shouldn't be a routine part of your treatment plan. It should be a routine thing that you ask about, but not necessarily recommend to everybody.
Many things that I didn't know before this talk. It's kind of embarrassing, but it was really fun. I really enjoy learning and really enjoy what you teach.
Thanks. Thanks, guys.